from the New Arts and Media Studios in River West, the greatest neighborhood in the world. I'm Charles Purcell, and this is The Log. Well, let's see. Let's start here today. Not the most important story in the world, but one that caught my eye. Looking at BBC News right now. An entire California school board has resigned after making disparaging remarks about families in an online meeting which they did not realize was being publicly live streamed. I'm sorry, I don't mean to laugh. nothing like getting caught on a hot mic. And that used to be a problem just for kind of high-powered folks and celebrities and big-time politicians. Now it's all of us, because we're all on Zoom meetings, and this was a California school board, and the cameras were rolling on this live stream. They want to pick on us because they want their babysitters back. That's one quote one of the school board members said about parents. Another implied that parents wanted their children out of the house so they could take drugs during the day. Parents, however, had been joining the public call as it progressed. Uh-oh, said board member Kim Bede, when she was told several minutes into the discussion, "We have the meeting open to the public right now." The WebEx meeting immediately went into private status. Okay, so I guess the reason I'm laughing, I don't know. Haven't we all seen this? In every work situation I've ever been in, this happens constantly. Not the getting caught part, the talking part. Has this been your experience as well? Have I just been sort of unlucky? But I can say without exception. I mean, from my very first job as a paperboy, I would tell my family and tell my friends about, Mr. Johnson was walking around in his underwear again when he came to answer the door. When I was collecting for the week, his red polka dot shorts, and I'd laugh and, you know, talk disparagingly about his legs. I'd get to see the insides of people's houses that were kind of unkempt. And you don't have respect. You talk about people. And often it's quite innocent and it's joking. And yeah, sometimes it's kind of mean-spirited. But as I had real jobs, my first real job, I guess, was at the Elkhorn Independent. Elkhorn's a small town in southeastern Wisconsin, Walworth County. They had a little weekly newspaper. I was part of a two-person advertising department. I got the job because I fancied myself an artist, and I thought putting together ads was a kind of a way to break into that. And they let me do some cartooning. It was very exciting. But to be honest, my job was mostly selling advertising, going to the local hardware store or car dealership and setting up their ads for the week. And then I got to do a little of what kind of touched on the fringe of art. But my boss, the advertising manager in my little two-person department, he had no respect for the clients. He'd give me little tips on how to sell them. Oh, they don't really know what they want. They don't know what they need. Just never much respect. Then later I worked in education. Oh, then it started getting really bad. The things that teachers would say about students and about the parents, all the time. In my eclectic career, I spent an awful lot of time backstage. I spent a lot of time on stage in theaters. If you love going to the theater, you ought to hear what the actors are saying about you backstage. I think this is universal. There's very little respect from the person who is providing the service to their customers, their clients, the people they serve. And I'm sure it goes the other way, too. The plumber who comes in to take care of your pipes. You know, as a customer, I think you're already feeling that you're getting ripped off. And the guy coming in, you know, the whole butt crack cliche is definitely true. It happens all the time. So you're feeling a bit superior to this guy. and a little angry that he certainly makes more money than you do. Whenever it comes to one person providing a service to another person for a fee, there's this natural tension. And so the kind of things that the school board people said are not at all surprising. I'm guessing that every school board in the country talks like this. Every one of them, every last one of them. This one happens to get caught on a online meeting, and they have to resign en masse. I don't know. This is just... So it was the board president who said that parents just wanted school to act as babysitters. And then the other one joked about parents wanting to take drugs. My brother had a delivery service for medical marijuana. His clientele were parents with their kids in school, he said, to laughter from the others. 2 days after the meeting, the entire board resigned. Man. In a letter to parents from the superintendent of schools, we deeply regret the comments that were made in the meeting of the Board of Education earlier this week. It is our responsibility to model the conduct that we expect of our students and staff, and it is our obligation to build confidence in district leadership. Our comments failed you in both regards, and for this we offer our sincerest apology. Please do not let our failure in judgment cast a shadow on the exceptional work that our teachers, administrators, and hardworking employees are doing. Good Lord. You know, I've just got really mixed feelings about the times we live in. I'm usually the guy who's defending political correctness. I don't use that term as a weapon. I think people should be kind. I think we should watch what we say, especially when it comes to people of color, women, LGBTQ, so-called marginalized people. Yeah. I mean, I'm the guy who wants to be PC. I think it's reasonable to have those expectations. We've done several segments on cancel culture, and generally I come down on the side of free speech, but I also usually think it's a pretty good idea for people to suffer the consequences of their bad behavior. That's usually me. But this particular story, I'm finding myself on the other side. I'm kind of thinking that the members of the school board should have just shrugged their shoulders and went, sorry, we got caught. Yeah, it's wrong, but you know what? Everybody does it. In this case, I'm finding myself on that side. They shouldn't have resigned. Let's just all have thicker skins. And again, I've experienced this in literally every office, every theater, any venue I've ever worked. People are talking about each other. It's not pretty. It's not a nice side of human nature. It's a little bit ugly. But it's real. Now, I think there's a better way to solve this problem. If we want people to have more respect for each other, we have to eliminate these class relationships. Relationships that automatically induce feelings of superiority. We were talking yesterday about how the nature of work just really needs to change if we're going to get anywhere at all. And part of that nature of work is that it creates in everyone's mind this class structure and who's paying who, who's in service to whom. And so you've got an attitude. You resent the plumber with the butt crack because you got to pay him more than you think he's worth, and you know he makes more than you do. And he's a big guy with a butt crack, and you feel culturally superior to him, and you resent him. And the plumber, I've never been a plumber, but if my theory is correct and everybody is just getting attitude about everybody else, I'm sure the plumber's coming in. If you're a plumber, call me and tell me I'm wrong. But plumbers, don't you go into every house thinking, man, God, these people are stupid. They have no idea. They could have fixed this probably. Half of the things they call me for, any handy person could fix themselves if they weren't just so spoiled and lazy. And then when I do come in, they don't treat me right. They look down on me. They got a nice big house. They haven't seen my house. Everybody resents each other. Parents and teachers blaming each other for their crummy kids' bad behavior. Well, you get paid. You're the professional. Do your job. Well, you're the parent. I'm doing my job. You can't expect me to do everything. I can't be a teacher and a social worker and a COVID nurse. I can't do all this. They only pay me so much money. I'm already forking out for supplies every summer to get ready for the fall. I'm working nights and weekends grading your little brat's papers. Everybody just has a resentment for everybody else. And I think it's because of money. It's because of payment. One person is paying the other person. Well, I'm paying taxes that pay your salary. I'm paying your big old plumber's bill. I always like to imagine the world I want to live in. Let's imagine the world where people don't resent each other. Let's imagine a world where one person provides a service, the other person is the beneficiary of that service, and they're both there without any class expectations. They're both there without any financial incentives. So the person serving you your meal, oh, there's another one, servers, if you've ever worked in a restaurant. Man. The attitude between servers and diners, whoo, that is fraught. But imagine a world where you go into a restaurant and you know that the people working in that restaurant are there only because they want to be, because they enjoy preparing meals and serving it to others. It's their calling in life. It's the only reason they're there. That's going to completely change your attitude. Now, after hearing myself talk here for the last few minutes, I don't want to overstate the case. I'm not saying that every single social relationship is doomed, that we all hate each other and servers are spitting in our food. No. But to the extent it happens, it absolutely happens. And I think it could be easily done away with. So in this case, I'm not going to be the one decrying bad behavior. I think it's very natural. But my big provision here is it's only natural in the context of money, wages, customers, service providers. It all comes down to human nature, which Marx understood as flexible, malleable, and shaped in large part by the world we live in, by the norms created, the expectations that are established because of the rules of the road. And those rules are very much understood by everyone. Who's getting paid? Who's doing the paying? Social relationships are defined by this greater world, and we just respond to it as humans. If we could make some fundamental changes to that world, our natures would change as well. It only stands to reason. We're not born with a particular human nature and destined to follow that nature throughout our lives. No, we're born into societies. We're born into the mechanics. We're born into a very particular world, especially when it comes to economics and work, that creates and defines these social relationships. And we just call it human nature, but it's not. There's nothing natural about it at all. It's something that's imposed on us. It's superimposed on us. Change the class structure, change the economic power structure, relationships will change, and what we call human nature would change. And I'd really like to see that world. But in the world we're in right now, people are going to be snarky to each other. And I think we ought to just kind of, there are times we need to just laugh it off. It's like, oh, okay, you caught me. Sorry. I mean, seriously, what do you suppose these same parents, again, we're talking about this entire school board that had to resign because they were caught online talking trash about the parents. I mean, let's think about this for a second. What do you think those very same parents have said about those very same school board members over the years, and they just haven't been caught? You know there's trash talk going both ways, don't you? Of course. We live in the world, right? We know. And half the time, maybe 90% of the time, you're just blowing off a little steam. You don't really know what's going on. Everybody thinks they're an expert at somebody else's job. I mean, that's just the way we are. So I feel a little bad for these school board members. what else? Well, speaking of online meetings here, the Senate was really humming yesterday. C-SPAN had it going on. You had your choice. Merrick Garland had his turn in the spotlight. Another committee talking about the January 6th insurrection and how and why that happened, kind of grilling Capitol Police officials. It was an interesting day in Congress. One of the best moments came from good old Tom Cotton. Oh, my God. We all know he's running for president, right? I mean, we all know that. This is what the Republicans have to offer these days. I'm looking at Slate right now. Tom Cotton demands to know if Merrick Garland supports equity. It was a very interesting exchange. Let me read to you here from the Slate piece. Senator Tom Cotton had some particular, if bizarre, questions on his mind Monday. Oh, this was Monday. Okay. Yeah, that's right. Yesterday was the second day. Okay, so this goes back to Monday. My mistake. So during this Senate Judiciary hearing for Merrick Garland, President Joe's nominee for Attorney General, Tom Cotton tried to get kind of cute. He asked about Timothy McVeigh, the domestic terrorist who was sentenced to death, and Garland worked on that case back in 1995. Cotton asked Garland if he regretted that McVeigh was executed in 2001, considering that he now holds a different viewpoint on the death penalty. Garland responded saying that he supported the policy during McVeigh's case and that he doesn't regret that. But I have developed some concerns about the death penalty in some 20 years since then, he said. Garland explained that the exoneration of death row inmates, the randomness of the policy's application, and the disparate impact on Black Americans and other communities of color were among what gave him pause. So this gives Tom Cotton his opening now. And he asks, okay, so would you support the death penalty today if someone like McVeigh or Dylann Roof, who was the white supremacist who murdered 9 Black parishioners in a Black church, would you support the death penalty in that case? So you see the little game he's playing here, the little racist game he's playing. As Slate puts it, listening to an enslavement apologist, i.e. Cotton, use the victims of a horrific hate crime in order to defend the death penalty was a perverse experience that underscores much of what is known about Cotton. Yet somehow it got worse as his questioning moved forward. This was the setup for what Cotton attempted to deliver as a gotcha. Are you aware President Biden has signed an executive order stating his administration will affirmatively advance racial equity? Not racial equality, but racial equity. Now, here's where Garland failed. Merrick Garland did not give an adequate response. He replied that he was familiar with the order and that equity was defined as the fair and impartial treatment of every person without regard to their status, including individuals who have been in underserved communities where they were not afforded that before. Now see, here's where Merrick Garland is wrong. He just defined equality, not equity. And so Tom Cotton so far is kind of winning. He's trying to get Garland to understand the difference between equality and equity, which in a narrow sense here, just in a definitional sense, I'm agreeing with Cotton, who asked Garland if he thinks racial... He got right to it then. He asked him if he thinks racial equity and equality are the same thing. Here's Garland's response. This is a word that is defined in the executive order as I just said it. So I don't know what else. I can't give you any more than the way the executive order defined the word it was using. So both men in this case failed in their missions. Cotton didn't bring it home, because what he was getting after is correct. There is a difference between equality and equity. Equality means that everyone is treated the same, given the same opportunities. And then the results of that equality in treatment the results are up to the individual. If you wind up rich or poor, privileged or unprivileged, that's all on you. If we've treated you equally under the law, then the rest is on you. And conservatives, right-wingers, white supremacists use this little tactic all the time. They use this as an excuse. They point to the law and they say, well, discrimination is illegal. The law says everyone is equal. So if you wind up still being underprivileged, that's on you. And we all know the numbers, people of color, the numbers are through the roof regarding every outcome imaginable. Education, jobs, healthcare, housing, everything. So there's obviously a problem. So that's equality. What is equity? Well, equity is the end results. Equity means that, for example, the black unemployment rate is not twice the white unemployment rate. It means that just as many blacks and Hispanics per capita are receiving the COVID vaccine as whites are per capita. It means that LGBTQ folks are able to live a life free from persecution and bigotry. So equity is results-based. It looks at the actual situation of people's lives. Equality, on the other hand, is aspirational in its nature. We don't know where you're going to wind up, but we'll give you an equal shot. So the fact that President Joe's executive order said that his administration will affirmatively advance racial equity, Tom Cotton has a very good point. A racist point. But his point is correct. And Merrick Garland missed a great opportunity to stand up and answer it. He just equated, pardon the use of the term, equality with equity, and they're not the same. This is just another example of Democrats, of liberals, hiding behind language rather than admit they're trying to do something progressive. They just, liberals, if they inch anywhere toward progressivism, they just can't admit it. They got to do it on the sly. Now, what I wish Garland had said, yeah, equality and equity are two different things. But if the concept of equality, however well-intended, if it's not achieving equity, then there's a problem. Just using nice, flowery language about equality isn't enough if it's not doing the job. The goal of equality in policy should be equity in real life. And that's obviously not the case. And I really wish Garland had made this argument back at Cotton. If equality is not achieving equity, then positive steps need to be taken, i.e., affirmative action. I mean, they dance right up to the edge. This administration will affirmatively advance racial equity. Affirmatively is right in the sentence there, is right in the executive order. But God forbid a Biden centrist sort of liberal admits right out loud that affirmative action is a good thing. Oh, God, can't do that. But that's really what it comes down to. And I'll say it once again. If equality in law is not resulting in equity in life, and that's been the case for years, for decades, then we've got to change what we're doing. So for the administration to affirmatively advance equity is the absolute right thing to do. And shame on Merrick Garland for not saying that right out loud and without apology to the racist Tom Cotton. So I'm unhappy with both of these guys right now. And they just left plenty of room. They left all the room in the world for the spinners on their respective news networks, news in quotation marks, to just spin this their way. Oh, look how Merrick Garland squirmed and evaded the question. I imagine that's what they're saying on Fox. And then over on MSNBC, they're saying, oh, look at this racist Tom Cotton. Well, both actually are true at this point. Very disappointing from both of them. This is what I keep talking about. We got to stop apologizing for progressive policies. Centrists, Biden Democrats, just get on board with us lefties, will you? Just try it. Try it for a couple of years. You got the House and the Senate with you for a couple of years. Fly your progressive flag Stop trying to sneak it through the back door. Stop trying to please everybody. Well, let's see. Have I got time for this? Yeah, last night we learned that Lawrence Ferlinghetti passed away. 101 years old. And, you know, every time he had a birthday, the last, 10 years or so, all through his 90s, every time he had a birthday, I made note of that and wished him well and would share it in my social media. Happy birthday, Lawrence Ferlinghetti. 101 years old. North Beach in San Francisco was my stomping ground for a few years there back in the day. And I spent, oh my goodness, I spent some very happy hours at City Lights. Just to be in that building, just to be in the place where it happened, where these great American thinkers, writers, cultural revolutionaries, where they just really made something happen. It was just a thrill. I spent many hours just soaking it up. Well, let me read to you the announcement from City Lights. City Lights booksellers and publishers. We are sad to announce that Lawrence Ferlinghetti, distinguished American poet, artist, and founder of City Lights booksellers and publishers, has died in San Francisco, California. He was 101 years old. Ferlinghetti was instrumental in democratizing American literature by creating, with Peter D. Martin, the country's first all-paperback bookstore in 1953, jump-starting a movement to make diverse and inexpensive quality books widely available. He envisioned the bookstore as a literary meeting place where writers and readers could congregate to share ideas about poetry, fiction, politics, and the arts. 2 years later, in 1955, he launched City Lights Publishers with the objective of stirring an international dissident ferment. His inaugural edition was the first volume of the City Lights Pocket Poets series, which proved to be a seminal force in shaping American poetry. Ferlinghetti is the author of one of the best-selling poetry books of all time, A Coney Island of the Mind, among many other works. He continued to write and publish new work up until he was 100 years old, and his work has earned him a place in the American canon. For over 60 years, those of us who have worked with him at City Lights have been inspired by his knowledge and love of literature, his courage in defense of the right to freedom of expression, and his vital role as an American cultural ambassador. His curiosity was unbounded, and his enthusiasm was infectious, and we will miss him greatly. We intend to build on Ferlinghetti's vision and honor his memory by sustaining City Lights into the future as a center for open intellectual inquiry and commitment to literary culture and progressive politics. Though we mourn his passing, we celebrate his many contributions and give thanks for all the years we were able to work by his side. We love you, Lawrence. So that was the message from City Lights. All right. Well, here's wishing you the best. I hope you're well. Hope you're hanging in there. Hope you're fighting the good fight every day. Do what you need to do. And do it in good health. I love you. I'm Charles Purcell.